opened my, well, all what I've done was inspired by Jim since now. So thank you very much. Then Majunda and Bhushan, yesterday you mentioned this. To be honest, why it's so popular? Yeah, not because of the model, the content model, but because it spotted that all the parameters, contact parameters, are resolution dependent. I think this was the main contribution. So the fatality in that sense, I think this is why we acknowledge, everybody is acknowledging this today. And probably inspired also other theories later on, looking at the resolution effect. Carbone Putignano, Molinari, Robbins, and this is a very nice paper with elastoplasticity. Anyway, I don't have to say anything. Jastebov, Alcio Molinari is also very interesting for the full contact limit, and so on. The electric thermal problem and physical analogies are also very interesting. There are a lot of nice data from the 70s, 60s. I will show something in the next slide. Jim, I think, made the best contributions on this. Algatov also was working on the analogies. I would like to acknowledge, and we did something also with Jim later. Friction, yeah, I loved the paper by Persson, something also very nice numerically and theoretical by Mike, together with Bore Brunetto. We did something in cyclic loading with Popov and Port in 2014. And well, Feinberg, we mentioned this already. Adhesion, Carboni, Mangialardi in Persson, I think is a kind of must, must read. And fluid transport, again, Persson, Lorenz. And well, I did something on with Qi Chang Yi in 2014, was to update the volume parameters depending on contact, because you change the form of your surface and the volume parameters change as well. And well, I think this was a tiny contribution on that topic. Biomimetic surfaces, yesterday we had not time enough, I think, to discuss about them. They are interesting problems. I think here Gorb is a worldwide expert. We were looking also at the some hydrophobic surface, here together with Claudia Bore, my postdoc. These are scanning electron microscope of a ginkgo biloba leaf, and you can clearly see first the texture. There are some channels and kind of texture here, you can clearly see different levels, and then a microstructure. But if you look at the spectrum, that is not really self-similar. So the PA, power spectral density function, power law, yeah, it's not really, maybe you have bifactality, some microstructure that show up only at the higher magnifications. So even more complex, let's say, configurations. The issue is that if we really need to cover all these scales or not for the hydrophobic surface. I think it's still open partially today. Okay, let me move to the real talk. Thermal electric contact conductors. Well, if you plot the thermal conductivity versus the nominal pressure, this is a very interesting problem for, for electric models in general, and also for mechanics. In general, when you have a problem of heat conduction, imagine also your CPU of your computer, you have a temperature here, there you have maybe a lower temperature, then in this way you have a flux, it could be a current, electric current, or could be a thermal flux, and you have roughness. Roughness is inducing a kind of additional, let's say, resistance at the interface, which can be also considered as a kind of fictitious thickness of a fictitious material to kind of boundary layer to place there. Okay, in the literature there were a lot of results, a huge dispersion, a really complex complex trend, I would say. We look at this together, I look at this together with Jim Barber, who is not here, unfortunately, and we started the approach using dimensional analysis, so no numerical method, really try to understand the phenomenon. And well, Jim proved in Jim Barber in his paper in 2003 that there is an analogy between the mechanical field and the thermal or electric field. In particular, the contact conductors is ruled by the stiffness. P is the pressure, D is the mean plane separation. So this term here is essential for the contact conductors. That's why yesterday we said waviness is important rather than tiny roughness, rough details. Okay, then in principle, could depend on all these parameters, effective air modulus, the pressure itself, the spectral moments. This is the lower scale cutoff, specimen size, upper scale cutoff related to a waviness. or a cutoff in general, fractal dimension if you have a fractal surface. Okay, then we try to simplify this to understand if using dimensional analysis, like in fluid mechanics, you can reduce the dimensional dependency. First, we consider the upper cutoff length and E as the dimensional independent quantities, and we obtain this expression. This is dimensional function, phi, unknown. Okay, and you can really already reduce something, a little bit. But let's do more. If you do more, first you see that alpha is bandwidth parameter that you can use instead of M0, M2, M4, then depends on D and also small delta and capital delta. So basically this dependency is already involved in the other parameter, so you can drop somehow from this functional dependency. Second, you can here introduce the electromechanical analogy by Jim Barber. So basically the contact conductance is related to the pressure according to this equation, rho is the resistivity of your material, and then we also define the dimensionless contact conductors by multiplying C times rho times capital delta. Okay, and then, you get again the same dependency here. Next is to, we look at this and we say, suppose to rescale your roughness, your height field by factor lambda. Automatically M0, square root of M0, will scale also by factor lambda. And although the contact problem is non-linear, you have a linear elastic field. If you stay in that framework, you will find another solution with the same contact area, in an augmented displacement, and also an augmented pressure, exactly lambda p. So, since the contact area doesn't change, and because the stiffness doesn't change for that rescaled problem, you see that basically the contact conductors in the two cases must be the same. So, if you don't rescale your surface and then you rescale by a factor lambda, you have the same contact conductor. So must be the function phi must be the same. Okay, this means that if you take, if you are more clever, you take a combination of these two parameters, so this one divided by the other one, like this. It's possible, you still keep the other one. But you see that here there is a big advantage. So if you use this dimensionless representation here, using this combination, these two parameters, instead of keeping them separately, then you have an advantage, and this is why. If you rescale again the problem, the geometry, you have lambda square root of M0. Here you will have lambda p, but lambda square root M0, so lambda is the same, you can remove, and then doesn't change this. And this must be again the same contact conductors, so again for the original not rescaled surface. And this holds for any lambda, so it means that we have no dependency on this dimensionless number. So you can drop this from the analysis. So using this single dimensionless number here is an advantage, because you can basically avoid to look at this dependency. There is not any longer. Okay, finally, the last step was, and this is actually something that has some troubles, because we said, well, supposed to have an incomplete similarity, something that was done by Barnblatt in his famous books, supposed to have an incomplete similarity also in the first dimensionless number. If it is true, then you could express a functional dependency where this is a kind of, you have a power law dependency on this number. This happens, as you know, in percolation, in many other problems in quantum mechanics. So why not also, maybe, in the contact conductors? However, the exponent beta is still to be defined. And usually you can define only with numerical tests or experiments. So anyway, unfortunately, there is no free lunch. Beta are still to be defined. But then, the functional dependency is very simple. Okay, you don't need to do thousands of tests. We try to understand if this is working or not, taking the old results by these people. Okay? They made a huge contribution on contact conductors. If you look at the original expression, there were correlations, they looked really, really weird. And somehow, many coefficients, you see very strange numbers. But then if you pack everything together using this dimensionless number, you always come up with something that depends only on those dimensionless numbers that we defined. Nothing more. Always the same stuff. The final expression is always something like that. And also, such a power law dependency seems to be confirmed, you see here. So anyway, we could reinterpret somehow all the previous existing models, and also correlation based on experiments. So it seems to work. Well, consider that you could plug there any model. You can also suppose to have an exponential distribution of prosperity aids, then this would lead to a linear, an exponential relation between pressure and separation, and this would lead to an exponent equal to unity. Okay, but here we don't find unity, we find something else. Then we also tested this numerically, making some tests, trying to uncouple the specimen size with respect to the upper cutoff length, capital delta. We created a big surface with different RMD patches, and then we increased the size as much as possible in order to uncouple the upper cutoff length from the specimen size. And we found that, without elastic interaction, which is the bearing error model everybody yesterday spoke about, and then you find this kind of relation, 0.82 as an exponent of the power law, then we included elastic interactions, like also we did in the model by Greenwood with Michele. In this case, it's a full BEM actually solution, so there is no assumption on asperities. And we found something like that, 0.72 and then 0.46. Still not clear to me exactly what happens at this scale. Anyway, something can be at this pressure level. There's still, I think, space for looking at this problem. Anyway, seems to be confirmed that you have a power law, not unity, not linear dependency, but something slightly different. Okay, then let's move to cardiomyocytes, because that result, which is important for mechanics, somehow, or electronics, is useful also for this topic. Okay, now I speak about something relatively new, maybe, to most of you. Cardiomyocytes are the main cells composing your heart. They have such a kind of behavior, you see here, they contract. And you have rough boundaries. First of all, you have also an anisotropic structure, fibrillar structure, and you have such rough boundaries there. Here you have a set of basically proteins and so on, leading to adhesion and functional behavior of the interface. Because, let me say, these myocytes alone are not so relevant. What is relevant is the interaction between them. They pass a lot of info between one to another. Electric information, there is a voltage, like in the electric problem we have seen before, but also physiochemical substances, like calcium. Okay? These are essential, and of course, we are mechanicians, and we know they transfer also tractions. Adhesion, contact, all of this is involved. Okay, so it's a relatively complex problem. Let's try to keep it simple. First of all, you see from experiments, they are very nice in class. You see that due to the roughness, this is the center of your cell, these are the interfaces, all this stuff, they are rough, they appear rough, basically. These dots are points where there is transfer of chemical substances. So you don't have a uniform transport of chemical quantities, only on some dots. These dots, at the nanoscale, they make such a model. They say it's a gap junction. Well, the gap junction is simply a point in contact. We don't know exactly the shape of this. Maybe molecular dynamics could help, or some more advanced imaging technique for biosystems. But let me say, it's a point in contact. You have adhesion everywhere, and then also some contact points. In these points, you have the electric current flowing through. Okay, and they are not always uniformly distributed. You see, you have different points. So I imagine this, from my background, could be related to roughness. Could be. Okay. So let me say, this is sketched at the nanoscale, and maybe something could be done at the scale to understand the behavior. But let me try to understand if we can, first of all, summarize the experimental evidence that could help us in thinking about a model, because there's not. Everything done so far in that field is for cellular automata. So they have rigid myocytes, and they randomly assume a certain change of properties from one or the other, and they try to understand the emergent behaviors. Which are the emergent behaviors? Well, due to the imperfect transactional conduction, you have diseases. There are some diseases in your heart that could be related to the imperfect transactional conduction at that scale. Quite interesting, so from the practical point of view, not just purely theoretical. But anyway, let me summarize what I know, and then we try also to make some assumption on the mechanical part, because nobody considers elasticity. It's a rigid body with just random transfer of properties. In reality, they deform, it's much more complex. There is mechanics inside. Alors, first of all, roughness, I said before, let's put as a first topic. Second, nonlinear adhesive and contact interactions. You can see this if you take an AFM test with two cells, you see a force distance kind of like this, then a kind of softening, and then a cutoff of adhesion. Anyway, this is not really related to the van der Waals force, but somehow for sure is the upscale behavior of these van der Waals interactions. Then people try to make some tests on a cell-cell, two cells, by imposing a voltage, the difference, and looking at the current through the cells. That's interesting, but they couldn't simulate this using, considering also the deformability of the cell. So they are, they don't deform, because it's difficult to let them deform in, not in vivo. I will show you why. They try now to cell on cell chip in Harvard, in Oxford, and also in Campus Biomedico to simulate also the deformation, but it's in the next step. We don't have the test so far in the literature. But in any case, from this test, there is no mechanics, but just conductance due to the change. Here you have a voltage gap, and then jump, and then you have current. What they find is that there is a conductance, nonlinear function of the, let's say, delta V, which is the jump in the voltage, and something like that. And this depends also on the type of protein you have there. Could be symmetric, not symmetric, but something that can be assessed experimentally. So we have this stuff. What we need is to plug mechanics, which is not available. So now I make hypotheses. Now it's a matter of a physicist more than an engineer. I try to do my best, although I'm not a physicist. So I try to make a simple assumption. First, I assume that for the mechanical response, the interface H, Z, are randomly distributed and can be encountered or adhesion depending on the sign of a gap function, Gn equal to Z minus D. D is the mean plane separation, as we know from quantum mechanics. Okay. I don't make any assumption here on the on asperities. It's just an elevation. That's supposed to work at that level. If Gn is larger than zero, supposed to have a nonlinear contact law. Two parameters. If alpha is equal to unity, then you have a penalty, linear penalty relation. Otherwise, you have a nonlinear penalty. Why not? Something like that I did also together with Giorgio Tavarese and Capintè in 2006 to have a full framework like that. So why not keeping this? These two parameters could be identified from experiments. For instance, AFM measurement on cell-cell. Well, then if Gn is less or equal to zero, you have a nonlinear adhesive law. I cannot assume a linear one, something too simple. But let me take something like this. It's something relatively simple. I'll show you now the picture, which is better than the formula. Tractions divided by sigma max. Sigma max is a parameter, can be estimated from AFM measurements. G max corresponds to the peak, also can be assessed from experiments. Then let me say I have a linear or nonlinear penalty in compression, relatively stiff, probably, and makes sense. And then, again, from AFM, I can also assess the behavior in tension. With A, I can rule the sublinear, linear, or hyperlinear behavior, and let me say I can have a fast or slower decay afterwards. Unloading, I suppose this, but I don't know really. This is something to be understood. It's not yet in the model. It's an open question, if it is true or not. For coincidence of models, it is true. For adhesion, I don't know. But I ask you if you have an idea. Okay, if we have this, then we can plug into, we look also at the electric field, which is essential. I suppose here that only contact spots contribute to the current transfer. So not those in adhesion, because anyway, they are separated. Makes sense with the tangential gap idea. I assume that the current in that spot is minus G times the jump in the voltage. G is the conductance, electric conductors, and I assume that is a product of two terms. One, depending on the voltage, jump, this is taken from experiments we have seen before, times a function of the gap. And why not? This is just according to the, if you apply the Barber analogy, for a single spot, you have the contact force, which is the penalty law, and then you can just apply this, you have the stiffness for that spot in contact, and this should be the contribution of that individual spot. Now, how much is the total current passing through the interface? It depends. It's an emergent property. I have to simulate the contact problem with a certain random distribution of asperities. For each point, I can assess if it is in contact or not in contact, if it is adhesion or not in adhesion. And then, overall, I sum up all the current contribution and I compute capital Q. This is the emergent property I'm interested in. Okay, let's see how to do this. Well, I need also the elastic interactions. It's a deformable body. And so I need to invoke, I need to pass to the finite element method. I cannot do by hand because there is also multiphysics inside. I will show you in a few minutes. So I propose this idea. Let's start with a continuous surface like this, rough. This is the average plane. Let's move to a discretized surface, as you do in BEM, okay? You step surface, stepped surface. But then I replace this by the flat surface with the average plane, but I introduce some interface elements, like in fascial mechanics. For each interface element, I store an internal variable, which is the, let's say, deviation of your elevation from the mean plane. That's all. And then I study the contact at that level. It's simpler. You don't have to use Bézier approximation and so on. Of course, this is an approximation. It's a model. It's not perfect. But I can take into account roughness somehow at this level without meshing this. In principle, I use the same mesh size, so it's the same discretization accurate as in BEM. And in this paper, by the way, with BEMBORAD, we improved the Polonsky and Kier method by a factor of 50. So it's 50 times faster, the Coupy algorithm we use there, as compared to Polonsky and Kier. Anyway, it's a minor contribution, in my opinion, today, because I would move to FEM. But for those using BEM, have a look, perhaps, to this paper. I think it's really good. All the algorithm is described as it's 50 times faster than Polonsky and Kier. Okay, let me say, then, it's the same interface discretization. No assumption on asperities. I have eights in each Gauss point, then I compute the contact response or the evasive response, like in fascial mechanics. I can also use something more complex for non-structured meshes. I've done something with Peter Vrigas last year, Pagi Vrigas in Kmame. And so I can also have not matched elements there, so a kind of not to segment or not to surface strategy. This is easy also from the interstellar point of view, it's flat. Okay, you need to have, of course, this new interface element, but it's simple to be implemented. You can also now address mechanical and geometrical nonlinearities, adhesive, frictional contact, multi-field problem. Yeah, it's a finite element method. We know it's better than BEM for this, it's the critical point for BEM. Okay, this is the way to construct the interface finite element. Well, I skip the detail, but anyway, easy. You work at the weak form and you build up your interface element. And the same you have to do for the continuum. Now, let me say something on the continuum. How it works, a myocyte, physically, from the physical point of view. Then there are some equations, but let me simplify what happens. Well, you have a reaction diffusion system. Diffusion is related to the voltage. You have your diffusive quantity. But there is also a reaction term, FB. This reaction term is produced by the chemical reactions that take place in the myocyte, because you have transport of quantities across the myocyte, calcium, for instance, which is essential. Calcium is as variable. G1 and G2 are also important. This is called a minimal model by Bueno Rovio, used also by Quarteroni. There is something more advanced on that, looking really at each chemical quantity. But let me say, I think it's enough. You can complicate this, to be honest. There's something more accurate. And in that field, there are really experts on the writing down the let's say reaction diffusion PDs. Then, what do you say? There is mechanics, however. Okay, then, allora, first of all, you have an anisotropic fibrilla structure. You can take into account in a diffusivity tensor that depends on this inclination theta of the fibers. So, there is a possibility to take this into account in 2D. Second, you have a finite kinematics framework, like for skin contact we have seen the first day. In particular, you have to consider multiplicative decomposition or the deformation gradient. The idea is simple. You have an anelastic contribution. which is related to the inelastic behavior there, and this is activated by calcium, and is ruled by such a stretching gamma of your fiber, of your myofilament fiber. Gamma S is the contraction in the opposite direction. But this is inelastic. Then you have the elastic contribution that in the end gives you the final, what you really compute, which is the total deformation gradient. So you compute this, you have also Fa, and then you compute Fe by inverting this expression. This is the procedure, basically. Okay, next, you have to couple mechanics with the other reaction diffusion, and this is done through such a S variable, which rules the stretching of the myocyte. So the stretching, that is an ordinary differential equation, depends on U, the field, the displacement field, the S variable, and gamma itself. It's nonlinear, again. So everything is nonlinear. Second, what is ruling the movement of this myocyte is the voltage. You impose a voltage, maybe a kind of pulse. You see the voltage passing through. Then there is also chemical reaction taking place, and your calcium is passing through the cell. And this is inducing stretching. And stretching is influencing your inelastic contribution in the strain tensor. And finally, you have the Piola-Kirchhoff stress definition. So it's complex, yeah, but anyway, took me some time because I had to start from scratch, you know, for 2 years for this topic. But let me say, in the end, now I have something working, fully coupled nonlinear electromechanical model. Again, this is the weak form, but let me skip this, it's boring. What is important is to say that you can solve this problem with different techniques. One that we pursued at the beginning, because I love that, I'm from Brigger's school, so I love the full implicit monolithic approach. So in this case, you create a finite element with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 degrees of freedom. So it's really monolithic. Then you write down your weak form, discretized weak form. You impose an implicit time integration, time stepping scheme. You compute your residual vector, and finally you perform a Newton-Raphson incremental iterative procedure. This is not what Quarteroni is doing. They are using a splitting technique. They solve the diffusion field, then they compute the other reaction fields, and then finally the mechanical one afterwards. Yeah, but it's not always converging, that field, okay? We found many examples where it's not converging, especially where you have strong nonlinearities. So the full monolithic approach has some advantages. However, to be honest, to compute the tangent operator is a pain. So, again, no free lunch. The explicit method maybe could be faster, but you don't know exactly how much is the time step you have to use. So, anyway, there are open problems. Let me show you what happens at this level. This is a simple test problem. You have one quadrilateral body. There is a fine mesh size. Here you impose a voltage pulse, and you see then the voltage propagating through, this diffusion, and at the same time the deformation of your body. And then you see what I mean in practice. This is your pulse diffusing, and you see the formation also coming through. Then there are the reactions activated, you deform, the wave is diffusing. Then at a certain point you stop, giving this pulse, you stop, and then everything tends to finally, again, the undeformed state when your voltage wave is through the body. Okay, so basically there's really strong coupling between the two fields. Okay, this is also what we started doing for from the PNAS paper. It takes time to build all this stuff, but imagine to have two myocytes, and we started looking at this problem. Well, we have boundary conditions, they are a bit tricky to represent the real behavior. We are still in 2D. There are some kind of bed of stiffs, of springs all around with different stiffness to mimic also the fluid around. This is a simplification. Also here, fluid mechanics would play a role around to give the right stiffness of the system. Anyway, you can see the voltage, the activation variable, which is the S variable. Anyway, the result, if you have a uniform, flat interface, is something like that. If you plot the total current, that emergent property, due to contact, for different gap, let's say, compression terms, and as a function of delta V, you have something like this. So the total current is a nonlinear function of delta V, but this we know, is basically due to that experimental result, and is weakly dependent on the level of compenetration in case of a flat surface. Then I wonder, is it is true or not if I have a rough surface? Maybe this is the important for the anomalous transjunctional voltage gap and so on. And so I took a very simple, don't be disappointed if it is not fractal or not. It's just a Gaussian distribution of asperity rates I generated with MATLAB. Very simple, sorry. Anyway, I don't know which kind of roughness is there. I don't have at the moment the data, but I could do maybe in the future. Anyway, Gaussian distribution of AX. And then this is some interesting result. First of all, it's a problem where you have a kind of large range adhesion. It's not a short range adhesion. And so adhesion has the same order of magnitude as the contact force. The adhesion component is also relevant. And I plot here the contact or adhesive force versus the mean plane separation divided by the root mean square roughness sigma. Okay, the adhesionless is what more or less we know, we expect to know, and I plot the result for a rigid interface or a deformable interface. What is the rigid interface? Well, without considering the elastic deformation. Something I can do just by hands. Anyway, a bit of computer, but I just sum up all the contribution, I impose the displacement, then I compute gaps, and I don't consider the elastic deformation, and then I can compute according to that constitutive law, what is in contact and not in contact. I sum up all of this, and I obtain the dashed line. Okay, in case of deformable interface, this comes from the hyperelastic model and so on, you find something like this. It's consistent with what we found also in the past, in the sense that when you have a deformation, then this is affecting your interaction, and what you see is that, okay, these are hyperelastic, maybe more complex, but it's like a mean average, mean contribution to the separation. It's like solving for a larger separation because you have a compressive state in your body, which is like basically enhancing, augmenting your separation. And so you have a reduced force. The force is lower as compared to the rigid interface. What happens if you have adhesion? This is something interesting to me with long range adhesion. You have the adhesive contribution in red, contact contribution in blue, and the total sum of the two in black. So the total one is still negative, so adhesion is prevailing over contact overall along the interface, but you have some contact spots. So when you have very large distances, no forces almost. You have only adhesive forces at this level, no contact forces. Then you come up with a load, other points come into contact, a bit less in adhesion, and yeah, anyway, the total force is still negative. But you see that from the rigid, the formal interface, you have the opposite trend as before. The opposite trend. This is because, I've seen from the numerical data, when I push them into contact, then the adhesive effect of the interaction is to push them even more together because they attract, and then other points come into contact. Overall, this adhesion is augmenting the contact load overall. This for sure depends on the range of adhesion. If you have very weak adhesion, probably this doesn't happen, you have something like this. On the other hand, when you have strong adhesion, this could also happen, which is also pretty interesting behavior.
Marco, yeah. I don't understand. Why, for very large separation, you still have adhesion?
Because you have still such a very weak, in the decay, you don't have a cutoff there. There is no cutoff. And actually, there is Gmax corresponding to the say softening is quite far, so you are really in the first range somehow where you have the peak, from zero to the peak of the adhesion before the softening range. You are really a lot of adhesion there. You are not yet in the softening regime, so you have still the maximum contribution of adhesion even if you are far.
That's what you
and this is the result you get. It's one example. I can say probably there are many other by tuning parameters, changing some. There are not so many, eh? There are not so many parameters. In the end, G max, sigma max, A, B, which is smaller than Rumi square, this is basically E, the modulus, alpha, epsilon, well, few parameters. I just consider alpha 1.8, I think is a nonlinear penalty parameter, it makes sense in my opinion. It's more stiff than the bulk, basically, the interface. But few parameters, not that much. Eh? Anyway, in the end, this is the behavior, totally different from uniform interface. It's not flat, and the effect of roughness is to decay, create a decay in the current as soon as this basically gap is increasing from 0 to 4. You are separating the myocytes. And so I think this could be useful as a future guideline to look at this problem in detail and try to understand if roughness or different form of roughness at the interface could affect or not the emergent properties, because for sure the voltage is drastically influenced by this and this is affecting the formation of your myocytes, so overall it makes sense that you can have a strong impact on possible diseases as well, anomalous transactional behavior. To be honest, this is a possibility. I chose this one because it's the most interesting one in the sense that you have such a long adhesive interaction. If you do, for sure, for shorter adhesion, then the contact response is more important, and so on. But I think in such a biological system, you have quite wide range adhesive interactions. It's a feeling, anyway. Also, some tests show this very long Q in the adhesive response from AFM cell-cell contact adhesion test. Okay, emergent properties, multi-field contact problem for biological cells. I think we tried to set up a computation method which is complex, but not that much, in the sense that, okay, you need to have complex behavior for the continuum. In other problems, maybe you can simplify this. It's enough an hyperelastic Neukar constitutive law, and you have a finite element code for this. You don't need to code everything in FIP, you use Abacus. But then maybe you need to look at the interface, and I propose something which is something a bit different. I consider this flat, and I keep the information of roughness in an internal variable. And then I don't look at the, let me say, at the asperity assumption or not. It's just one contact spot, which is certain elevation, and there is, of course, a constitutive law, the nonlinear penalty law. This could be motivated by maybe, I don't know, Jean-François molecular dynamic simulation at that scale, or something like that. And then I can plug this as a constitutive law of a single spot. Then adhesion can be included, friction could be the next step, although I think there's still enough to dig. Emergent properties from the interaction between multiple cells is very important, is a collective behavior, and we need to look at this. This is an example. If you have only until this cell-on-chip testing, they can do one single cell, two cells, multiple cells in contact. And what you see, this is the surface tension and the number of cells, basically. And you clearly see that depending on the number of cells, the surface tension is changing at the interface. So there is an effect of the size and emergent property of the interface. And then finally, the relation between forms of gap junction imperfection, roughness, in my opinion, and diseases. Because consider that there is also, up to now they say, you have a so-called remodeling. In other words, you have also aging somehow of your transactional voltage. They show that some points around the interface become stiffer and they don't allow any longer the deformation, the deformability of the myocyte. So somehow everything happens there at that level. And this kind of less ability to deform at that level is the result of a disease. Okay. And finally, I would like to acknowledge the RC starting grant is on durability of PV modules. You can say, well, this is not really the topic of today, but in this framework, first of all, we made a lot of progress on durability of PV. You see such cracks in solar cells embedded into PV modules. Anyway, we found a lot of multi-field problems also there. And this is why, as a side effect, because I was studying multi-field problems and partial differential equations, then I got interested also in other similar problems, because in the end they have some similar feature. That's all. Thank you very much for your attention.
because in your case, when this process is reversible, meaning that if you remove the voltage, then the excitation gets sent back to the initial state. And in real muscles, you have this fundamental active unit, the sacrum here, that works only in one direction.
This model is used typically by people in that field to model also the sacrum. I'm not looking at the scale, which is bigger than this, but they use this model, exactly this model, basically Quateroni papers. Then I didn't look at the detail because I'm more interested in interface behavior, but the model, the PD, everything there is exactly for the continuum, exactly that by Quateroni. So if they model this, then the same happens here. The same happens here.
I understand that you're mostly interested in the ruffles, but I thought that the purpose of the gap junctions was to make the individual cells beat in the same frequency. Mm-hmm. Because individual cells, if you look at them, then they beat at certain frequencies, and it's their communication that gives the aversion behavior of beating all at the same time.
Sure.
Now, is that difference in beating frequency somehow incorporated in the model?
No, you see this from it must come naturally. You should not impose somehow in the model, in the sense that everything is related to the what happens at the interface when you have your voltage diffusion. It's an imperfect one. What you clearly see is that they start contacting together. You see this from maybe this one. They contract, interact. Here you have this interface and two myocytes. Everything is ruled by the electric voltage is passed through and the chemical substances. So if you change them.
Do they have different diffusivities?
In this case, no.
No.
This one are the same.
The
interface is different. But you change one parameter. If you change this, you change this one. You have the pullback of the diffusion tensor, you change the tide for each. For instance, you can have also more, in this case they are aligned, the fibers. The filaments are aligned, so the same theta. You can change the direction. In reality, probably some of them are also with different inclination. And then you have to tune on this. Yeah. To be honest, that is complex. I kept only the same alignment, because if you consider maybe one 90 degrees compared to the other, then you could have some instability in the process. Because you have to consider that you have a model which is almost incompressible, and maybe in some cases you could have some troubles related to this. So the anisotropy is important. This model works well if they are not completely aligned, but similarly, let's say, not too much. So 190 degrees, the other zero could be critical, to be honest.
Okay.
You started with this measured dependence of the resistivity on the voltage, but that was macroscopic, I mean, in that scale. And then you plug it at the microscale. So this is back to the questions. Yesterday, whether you can transfer the same behavior from the one scale to another. I would say you should have something at the microscale and they get the macroscopic resistance as a result of your micro.
It's something to be debated. To be honest, in my opinion, what I keep there is only the the conductance versus voltage dependency. What I plug on the other end from the micromechanical model is the mechanical dependency. This is based on the constitutive law that is a nonlinear penalty, nothing to do with the macro scale. And then from that I get the response for the upper scale. I don't know, who knows exactly how to transfer that. In any case, the cell is about 10 micrometer, that test is then at 10 micrometer. It's a very specific test, they don't have the chemical transfer of quantity, so they cannot look at the deformation up to now. They are now trying to make this new testing machine to test them in the lab with also microfluidics, because if you don't have this, you don't let them alive and behave. So maybe in the future we can look better at the voltage. My assumption yet is to take that relation and use also that one, because really related to such a nonlinear dependency, it seems to be strongly dependent on the type of protein you have in interface.
But you could have evaluated
no, this one no.
The macroscopic one, the one
no.
Effective.
No, you can. What you can do is maximum this one, this term. This you can compute also from globally. I do, because the contact, the total flux depends on this. This is the local property, and what I get is the emergent property. This I can compute. I cannot compute this.
But you plug this figure if I'm on the left.
Right? See, this part.
You plug it in.
Yeah.
At the micro scale, but you could then evaluate what is the macro. You cannot.
Not for this. I don't think so for this.
Okay.
I don't think so for this. For the mechanical part, yeah. The mechanical part here is a micro scale assumption, and then, in fact, it's small q. The global q is the total sum. I think you have some trouble for this. But anyway, we have to think about it. We have to think about it. It's a good suggestion.
You said you replaced the interface with this nonlinear element with an internal variable inside, right? I was wondering if this approach can be used even if you have relative motion at the interface.
Yeah, in that case I would store as an history variable, and then I have the history variable there and can update it during the process. Easy. Yeah. Yeah, it's a good suggestion also for studying. You're right, such a finite displacement motion and so on, look...
Because I wonder, you have then two mesh,
yeah.
That maybe can not be any more aligned.
History variable then. Yes. Then you store this in history variable, you don't need to read at any time. Here we had 10,000, let's say, elevations. Something I could do myself, so without too much power. In 3D, of course, it's more challenging. We are looking at the application of that scheme also for a 3D roughness. And comparing this with BEM, linear elastic problem, still a bit academic, but maybe we can assess the level of accuracy of this. Today I wanted